Got a lot of things to talk about in this month's Stephenomics. Without further ado, Stevie, welcome back. Good to have you back with us on Market Edge. Hi.
Hi, welcome from New York.
Happy Lunar New Year.
Happy Lunar New Year to the viewers and to you.
All right. So, Stevie, this rewriting of the 40-year-old Constitution, at least from the outside, seems to be one of the, you know, the needle that breaks the camel's back in this love affair between the country's two most powerful political families today. I wonder, do you think this is really necessary, or is this much ado about nothing when really we can achieve the economic leniency everybody says they're after without cha-cha? Are there more creative, surgical ways to do these amendments?
Well, I mean, okay, I don't want to, too many people like to right away condemn the motives of the people they disagree with when maybe they just disagree with them. And I'm old enough to know some people are always insincere, some people are always sincere, most people are in between. So rather than try to define the motives, let's just discuss the reality. The reality is a lot of people, people who I have great respect for, like Gerardo Sicat and other people, I think are very sincerely believe opening up the economic provisions is necessary. My personal view, and I'm not assuaging the motives of people who disagree with me, is it's not only unnecessary, it is a wrong analysis of why we got left behind. In the last two weeks when we had our talk ahead of schedule or a special show, I talked about how most Asian countries have similar or even more severe restrictions than us. And yet they're the darlings. Look, I've represented a toll road in Malaysia, and we had to find buyers who were willing to be limited to 49% because it cannot be majority foreign owned, because there's real estate, and real estate has to be majority Malaysian owned. Same thing in Thailand. You know, I mean, so it's not like we are the outlier. We are frankly in more or less, I would say, the third quartile for liberalization of industries. Maybe we should change something on media because that's zero and all that stuff. But let me get to why I think it is wrong. It's because there is a problem. The problem is we've had abysmal economic performance since the 1960s. Now, what is the cause? If people say the cause is the provisions, I'd say, why don't you test your hypothesis by checking what other things happened over the last 60 years? Like, let's use an extreme situation. When did the Indonesia, Malaysia, and Thailand, well, Indonesia's having a renaissance now, which we can get to later, but their initial big bursts where they really started leaving us in the dust was in the 1980s. Was it economic provisions? Of course not. The economic provisions in those other countries were the same. What was it? We defaulted on our debt in 1983. We had to suspend our economic payments. Who's going to invest in a country that cannot service its debts? Number one. Number two, let's not pick on one administration. When we had EDSA, what did we have from 1986 to 1990? 9 coup attempts. Are people come? You think if we had 100% foreign investment, people will come in when we couldn't service our debts and we had 9 coup attempts in 4 years? Mm-hmm. I mean, would it at least be fair to have a proper study of all the differences? Because the irony is, there are no major differences in the economic provisions. Mm-hmm. Sorry, can you hear me or not?
We can. Go ahead, Steve.
Sorry, can you hear me?
I can.
So my point is, there are many reasons we got left behind. And I would say political instability in the first Aquino administration, and the suspension of debt service towards the end of the first Marcos administration were probably the deciding factors. You had economic instability and political instability. It sadly coincided with the time when the major American, European, and Japanese multinationals started investing in manufacturing facilities in Asia. All right. Number two is, as a result of that, we also have higher power prices. If you look at manufacturing, depending on how advanced and heavy it is, anywhere from 20 to 60% of your costs are power. It takes a lot to turn iron ore into steel. You don't do it with a few light bulbs and air conditioning, which is what you have in a mall. All right. So if you start out with power rates, which are anywhere from 25 to 50% more expensive than our neighbors, are you going to put up a steel plant? Are you going to put up car assembly? When you start, then third, which is another reason, is you don't just decide, I'm going to go some. Okay, you know what? New York is one of the most expensive places to live. But why has Wall Street been centered there for two centuries? It's not that others haven't tried. It's because you have the whole ecosystem and financial supply chain there. Same thing like in Singapore is no longer the cheapest place to build oil rigs. But why? Because you have the whole supply chain for parts manufacturers and all that stuff making it happen. So I would rather we have a serious discussion about what is holding us back, taking a view where let us study all the differences. We can look back historically. What were the reasons people said they moved to this place and that place versus us? What is its applicability today? But I would tell you, economic provisions are probably, okay, I don't want to anymore say whether philosophically you should be in favor or against. But the reality is we're probably above average in the region, without even going to first world countries and everything. We are above average in the region for the level of economic openness. Now, as I said, there are some which are more extreme where maybe we can fix it, like media. But if you take the issue as a whole, we are above the middle of the pack on openness to foreign investment. And please don't bring up this. Everybody can have them. Thailand, Malaysia, Vietnam, they all have restrictions on land as well. And read the papers. Even Singapore is now restricting because it's driven up the price. So let's get real rather than just say, this is ideologically what I believe in. And I want to go and say one more thing, which I find a bit sad in the discussion. Well, I remember when I was in my teens and 20s and I would discuss things, I would always say, God, those people teaching me and everything, they're so old-fashioned, they're not up to date, ta 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 ta. Well, now that's me. That's us. The decision makers are all in their 50s, 60s, and older, most of them. And guess what? It sounds like what we were thinking about in the 1980s, because that's what was big at the time, Washington Consensus, privatization. In the 40 years since then, economic thinking and theory has moved on. But maybe lack of critical thinking and intellectual curiosity has limited. Because of what the formative years where people's economic thoughts and so on were developed, their thinking is what was prevalent then, not what works now.
So, and that's why we have these Stephenomics conversations to try to stimulate the thinking, the creative thinking. Just very quickly, Stevie, on power.
Exactly.
On power, I did talk to some energy officials from the DOE, and they said, you know, power is not really cheap in our ASEAN neighbors. It's only cheap because the government subsidizes big portions of it. Do you think it's time for a government to think about subsidizing to make it affordable, attractive for foreign investors to invest here?
Okay, let me answer a very simple thing. If everybody wants a blue dress and you're selling a red dress, you can talk all you want whether it's fair that people prefer blue to red. But, you know, I mean, power generation in Vietnam is very unattractive. They tried to privatize one of the government generating companies. They asked me if I wanted to bid for it. The total return was 2%. All right, the equity return at the time I looked at it. So subsidy means you're getting below market rate, not you're losing money. Okay, so first let me make that clear. Now, it is a challenge for Vietnam now to keep adding power because they're saying the government has to do it because the private sector is not getting a return commensurate to their cost of capital and return parameters. Now they're starting to move in that regard. But basically, some countries like Indonesia and Vietnam said there are certain things more important than profit, like development. And we will let a government-owned private sector provide adequate and cheap power to spur manufacturing, because on average, every manufacturing job adds 5 to 7 more high-paying jobs. So it was policy. Now, whether we want everything to pay for itself and how and cover the cost of capital, that is a policy issue. Now, other people have done it. Some have done it without success. Others, like Indonesia and Vietnam, have done it with great success.
All
But it's
right.
a approach to government issue and development, which will never happen with us if we keep having this Washington consensus point of view, because that is basically against what the Washington consensus says. Now, if you tell me the typical answer everybody says, can we afford it? Well, here's what not affording it has given us in the last 40 years: substandard development compared to our neighbors. You know, anybody who goes to business school learns there's things about loss leaders. Why does Costco sell chicken at $4.99 up to now? Because they put it at the back of the store. By the time you go through the front and to the end of the store, you've spent $200 because you bought that $4.99 chicken.
All
Why
right.
does governments all over the world spend for cheap infrastructure? Because it brings in other things.
All right. Point well taken. Stevie, just I wanted to get your take. Another point of contention for all this talk about Cha-Cha, aside from economic revisions, at the back of everyone's minds, everyone's thinking, maybe they want to extend terms, limits to terms of government officials. I know you have thoughts on this, very interesting thoughts, really, on how this could actually work, if you're open to sharing it with the
Okay,
readers.
I have counterintuitive thoughts, because if this is really, if this, okay, so if this is really just an argument for term limits, let's have a frank argument about term limits. What do the people in favor of removing it say? Why penalize people who are doing a good job and the existing term limits don't work? What do
Okay,
We
I
don't
think
want dynasties. It's now what is my suggestion? This is just a suggestion,
Stevie, before we
having
get to
seen
your
what other countries.
Stevie, before we get to your
Sorry.
suggestion, I'd like to cut you very quickly because we're losing your audio and your video. We'll try to reconnect. Hold your thought. We're going to go back to you as soon as the line improves. All right? Stevenomics
Thank
will be
you.
all right, we'll be back online. Hold your thought there. Stay on the line, Stevie. Let's now go back to Stevenomics. I think he's back on the line. Stevie, hi.
I hope it's clearer now.
Cool.
Shows you problems probably in New York side, which is kind of embarrassing. Anyway, so show you how
Very,
good the
very
infrastructure.
clear. Very
All right,
clear. So,
now,
Stevie, what is the solution to the term limits?
okay, it's not, I don't want to say it's a solution, it is my suggestion. When people try to harmonize the issues, so as I said, the anti-term limit change people say this is a slide to dictatorship if we do it, et cetera, et cetera. The pro-changing limit, removing term limits say, why will we take people, qualified people out? Why will we limit their service? And the existing term limits don't work anyway, except for the one term for the president, which is an absolute limit, because you've got people coming back after one term, giving it to their other members of their family or extended family or trusted allies. So Why don't we just try an experiment? Let's think a little differently. Let's look at what's been successful in Latin America. Lula is president for the third time, even though they're only allowed 2 terms, because they just say you are limited to 2 consecutive terms. So if you take a break, you can come back if the people want you. So what if we said for the presidency, you're 1 term, and then you cannot be reelected, but you're good and you're young enough, try again. But that way you don't have a dictatorship that perpetuates itself because he'll just keep winning and winning and you have a slide. So why don't you allow non-consecutive terms? Now, on the Senate, I would suspect part of the reason there's a lot of movement in the Senate against charter change is because they don't want the Senate to be abolished. They spent a lot of time, they spent a lot of effort building up their political careers. But yet, when they're term limited, you see them run for Congress for 1 year and then try the Senate again. What if we just said we will consider going unicameral, but it will not be done immediately? It will be a phase out. 6 years, whatever, so that the people who invested the time and the money to build their career will not basically say that was time spent, effort spent, capital spent for no return. Have a sunset clause that maybe in 6 years or in 12 years, the Senate will expire. And they will have time to reboot their careers to be Congress. Now, if they say, oh, the Senate is a good ground to become president, it's good testing, other things will develop, other things will come up so that people can then promote themselves if they think they're worth becoming president to become president. First of all, the vice presidency has actually also been very good. Second, President Duterte was a mayor. President Ramos was a cabinet official. So it's not as if it's the Senate only. So if instead of abolishing it, you phased it out, maybe it will be less painful. And on presidential term limits, what about just non-consecutive terms? So that people have a more balanced way to weigh whether the person was good or not, and is not using patronage to get elected again. These are things which have happened in other countries, and some cases successfully, some cases not. But instead of just having a yes or no, or I'm for it or I'm against it, can we start actually having a proper discussion and thinking holistically and broadly? And more important, if we can't come up with great original thoughts of our own, can we see then at least what other people have done and whether it's worked or it's not worked?
But
As I
Stevie,
said, Brazil's a good example.
but Stevie, it begs the question, do you think we should abolish the Senate for whatever, whether it's face out or just abolish it?
Okay.
Don't you think it's going to delete the checks and balances?
Last I heard, every president has absolute control of the Senate and the Congress. And even when he does, if he or she is unpopular, he ceases to have it anyway.
All right.
Isn't it the truth? In my view of political coalitions in this country, 90% of the people in the opposition are not allowed to join the majority coalition. That's the reason they're in the opposition. It's not ideological. And then guess what? As I said, Cory Aquino had 22 out of 24 senators, and then ERAP joined her pa. So she had 23 out of 24, but she couldn't get the US basis treaty extended. So when you're popular, do you need is the does the Senate act as a check? When you're unpopular, does having everybody in your coalition lead to success and your programs pursuing it? It's popularity.
At the end of the
It's
day.
not, it's, are they scared of the political retribution of the president? That determines whether your program succeeds or fails. Ramos, when he won, he had 2 out of 24 senators. He had 20 out of 200 congressmen. But yet, the Venetian became speaker and he got all the reform packages passed because he made a good case for it, and he built
Car.
a political backing and society and the public supported them. Because guess why they supported them and trusted Ramos? Because in less than 1 year, 12-hour brownouts became a thing of the past. So he had credibility. So my view is check and balance is in theory. If you're popular, you won't be checked. If you're unpopular, you won't get it done.
All right.
That's my view of the reality in the Philippines.
Stevie, let's not get carried away with the politics. I wanted to end our conversation with this. The president launched Bagong Pilipinas, the New Philippines Initiative. It's very hard not to compare it to one of the very interesting reads you sent a few days ago about how the Joko Widodo era remade Indonesia's economy through the nickel boom and infrastructure splurge. I wonder, how can BBM, you think, from your perspective, fundamentally remake the Philippines?
Okay, what is the most popular steakhouse in New York? Peter Luger's. You know why? Everybody said everybody copies their style. So that means it's the most popular because imitation is the most sincere form of flattery. So it has worked for Indonesia. What did Jokowi say in 2014? No more raw nickel exports. And everybody complained. People complained to the WTO. Guess what? In 2014, when he did it, exports were 1.4 billion. But because they were the largest nickel export in the world, eventually after the stockpiles ran out, everybody started investing. Either locals did it, foreign people did it, joint ventures did it, to move up to finished products. Because he saw nickel was going to become very important for green energy and electric cars. You guess what was the exports in 2022?
What?
So in 2014, so in 8 years, 22 billion. Oh, wow. And the estimate for 2023 is 25 billion. From 1.4 billion to 25 billion in 9 years. Because guess what? You export nickel ore, it's nickel ore. You export a finished product that is used and plugged into green energy, it has higher value. And now he's saying we're going to do the same thing for bauxite so that it will be, we'll integrate the aluminum industry and we'll integrate, we'll do the same with copper. And now it's expanded also to, you know, chemicals and all that. And it was on the back of infrastructure spending that was aimed at, because a lot of the value add nickel products were near the mine sites, so they were far from urban areas, to make it accessible to transport, whether by road, rail, or boats. So he had an vision, and he had an integrated plan. If we're really that incapable of original thought, then let's just copy it, because we're the number two exporter of nickel and we're the number two exporter of copper in the region. So
Maybe it
won't become as big. It won't become 20 billion in 9 years, but it'll be a lot more than it is now. So if we're going to do the Bagong Pilipinas, let's really have, as I said, integrated and cohesive thinking and planning, not slogans, not ideological prejudices from 40 years ago.
All right.
Let's look at, if we cannot come up with original things, then let's look at real relevant applicable success stories. And what Jokowi did in nickel and now is doing with bauxite and copper is something we can adapt and, if not completely replicate, at least follow many aspects of it. And this can reap benefits even by the end of his term.
All right. On that note, we're just going to have to leave everybody else with this cliffhanger. Thank you, Stevie, for joining us this morning. We'll see you in a month.
Bye.
All right.